Hi everyone, as I was introduced, my name is Kevin Winter. I'm a developer programs engineer here at Google on the developer relations team, and I support the AdWords API. I'm going to be talking about some updates to reporting for v201109. To start off with, the v13 report service was introduced a while ago, also pretty limited. V13 report service is fairly old. It's been around for a while now. It was originally intended to be sunset in August of 2011. So starting with v201109, we're using kind of a new paradigm, a new way of approaching reports. Calls to the API report download service are free. We have a number of improvements we've been making to v201109 to make it a very suitable replacement for running lots of reports and removing some of the downsides of v201101 and making a much more viable alternative to v13 cross-client reports than v201101 ever was. So to give you a quick example, this is what a v201109 report definition looks like. It's fairly straightforward, as I mentioned before. You have a selector, which in this case only has a list of fields. You can add predicates to the selector to specify, you know, I only want to get my active campaigns. Your report name is mostly for your own use at this point. You can still specify the report type, your date range type, which will be using one of these dynamic date ranges we added in v201101, or you can use a custom date range and specify them on the fly for, you know, 3 quarters ago, which is something the current dynamic date ranges don't support. When making an ad hoc report request, as mentioned, you actually send the report definition as the HTTP request body when downloading the report. You can make an HTTP post request, or you can make an HTTP get request. I'll go to that in a few seconds. But when you make these requests, you need to still specify authentication and client customer ID headers. As I'll get into later, you're going to only be able to use client customer ID and 2011.09 and forward. The body of the request will need to be URL encoded. In the previous example, when I showed you the report definition XML, it was not simply for clarity. But when you're making these requests, you will need to encode URL encode the body. This is just in case you have any, you know, non-URL safe characters in there, so that when we interpret the request, we know exactly what you mean. You're going to want to use the you're going to use a name parameter underscore underscore rdxml to reference the report definition. So when you send your report request, you can use the content type of form URL encoded, which is a very common content type. This is supported by many HTTP libraries and many languages. And all you need to do is just make sure that you do URL encode the body and use the request parameter is going to be underscore underscore rdxml. So when you're making report downloads, you still need to specify some form of authentication. A lot of times when you're managing a lot of reports, we strongly recommend that you use an MCC account to manage these accounts and use a auth token requested for that specific MCC. So when you download your report, the only thing that's changing every time is the client customer ID header. The other option you now have is OAuth authentication, which is new for 2011.09. You can now use OAuth to access the MCC or even to the individual accounts if that's the way you want to do it. And you can sign each individual report download request using the OAuth access token and still specify the client customer ID to identify which account the report will be for. So here's an example of how a report request will look. You have your URL, which, as you may note, is now versioned. You now have adwords.google.com/api/adwords/report-download, which was your normal URL, and it's now /v201109. This is also new for 2011.09. The key benefit of this is that now we can start versioning report downloads. So instead of having us make a change that changes the way the reports return, we can now make them in a version change without having you worried about your code instantly breaking because we have to fix a bug or make some change that when your code is relying on a slightly older version of the API. You're still going to use your HTTP post request headers, such as client customer ID, your authorization, which will have the auth token specified with the Google login, and your content type is form URL encoded. And the request body would look very similar to this, except that, as I keep mentioning, it does need to be URL encoded just to make sure that we can correctly interpret your request. So now we're going to show you in Java how you can download that report using very simple library. So we're defining a very simple interface here where you're specifying the auth token, the CID, and the report definition XML, which are the three key components. If you're downloading for a lot of accounts with an MCC's auth token, The only thing that will be changing when you make this request will be the CID for each of these subsequent requests. In our case, we're using an HTTP URL connection, which is built into the Java JDK. It's also supported on App Engine if you ever decide to develop for App Engine. And what we do is we open a connection to our report service URL. We then set doOutput, which is basically saying we're going to be putting stuff in the request body. We set our request properties, i.e. HTTP headers, for our client customer ID, the authorization, and the content type. And we set the request method to post, because we're going to be posting the message to them. Then we're going to just obtain a output stream writer and wrap that around the output stream for the HTTP URL connection, so we can make we can write directly to the request body. Next, we write our parameter rdxml _rdxml, and then we URL encode our report definition XML, as I said, so we can interpret properly. Then we simply get the response code, which actually makes the request and interprets the response and gets to know what the result is. I'll get into what these status codes will mean for you in a little bit. But in our case, we're simply checking, is the response okay? Which means that the report download was successful. And in this case, we're simply creating a temporary file. We are copying function body omitted from the input stream of the connection to the output stream of the file. And we're just closing that and returning back a reference to the file. There's a lot of things you can do right here. You could, you know, write it into a database, do some later processing, what have you. But in this example, this is all we're doing. So when the report request finishes and you get your HTTP response code, these codes will mean different things. 200 is okay. It means your report downloaded successfully. The response body will contain your report as requested. 400 indicates a bad request. It means that there was something wrong about the request that you made. Maybe you forgot to URL encode the report definition. Maybe you know you're missing a header. Maybe you didn't specify the content type properly. These will return as 400. 500 is an internal server error. This covers any number of things. It could be a transient temporary failure. It could be some other sort of internal problem. But generally, this is the type of issue that shouldn't normally be happening. You should be able to retry after a short wait just to make sure. Another thing is you will get rate exceeded errors if you make 200 report requests too quickly from here. So you definitely want to double check this. And if you get this, you want to delay before making another request just so that you don't hit our service too much and get blocked. The other thing to mention is that when you do get anything other than a 200, the response body will contain in, some text that will tell you a little bit more about why you received this error. It'll tell you that your report definition was invalid, or it might say that you're just the request itself was wrong, but it will give you some more information. We also have an explicit flag for getting rows with zero impressions. In v201109, we will not include zero impression rows unless you explicitly add this header and set it to true. So we also added a new criteria performance report. A lot of people have asked for this. We previously had our keywords performance report, URL performance report. Now there's a simple criteria performance report that includes all of these types of criteria in a single report. So you can get consistent statistics across all of your criteria in a single report instead of requiring several reports or relying on special behavior in the keyword performance report.